Jessica Kingsley Publishers, an imprint of John Murray Press, presents Parenting When You're Autistic. Tips and advice on how to parent successfully alongside your neurodivergence. Written and read by Pooky Knightsmith. Dedication. For Ellie and Neris, who inspire me to learn more, love more, and laugh more. Forward. Written by Neris Hughes, founder of Whole Child Therapy. I am so grateful to Pooky for writing the book so many parents need to read. When Pooky came into my life, it was during the COVID-19 pandemic. In her wonderful, autistic way, she asked me to help other parents by making a list of things parents could do to manage. I, being my ADHD self, exclaimed, "A list? Never! Sorry, nothing so concrete from me." My answer in short was, there are not enough hours in our day. The task at hand is not viable. What we all need is to drink wine and admit we are not going to get all of this done. And so a friendship was formed. I am the honest puck-like disruptor, Pooky, the goddess of structure and curator of order. Together we travel the country. Pooky with her neatly ordered, well-thought-through mnemonics, me with my scattered hypotheses, rapid pace, gut-wrenching honesty, doing things that make Pooky shudder, like changing my workshop 5 minutes before we go on stage. In truth, we should be each other's trigger warning, but we are not, because as we find in this book, we saw each other. Our neuro-radar was strong. We found a safe place in the sea of normative expectations. Full confession, we do have our human shield, the ever neurotypical, well-regulated and deeply compassionate Agent Ellie, our work mother, who makes sure we get from A to B and remember to eat. What we have had from the very first day is a sense of acceptance, knowing, joy, a place to ask, what do you think? Is this okay? Or guess what my amazing child did today? During our journey, we've taken our children through a number of obstacles, suspensions, school non-attendance, provisions, bullying, homeschooling, and the worst of the worst. Our children stating they hate themselves. They feel not good enough. They're not safe. We shared fears, tears, hurt, frustration, and of course, solutions. When Pooky tentatively told me of the book's content and her approach of asking our community for their voice, I was overjoyed. I have spent my career forging a safe place for children and their families, and have been witness to so many dehumanizing approaches thrust on both parents and children in the name of normalizing us all. So many times being spoken at, spoken for, when really, here, within our community, the answers exist. I have worked with heroic parents and children. It's been a privilege and an honour to be part of so many lives, to see so much beauty, courage and magic. For so much of my career, I was the salmon swimming up the river in the opposite direction to all the other fish. In the last decade, I have found other fish swimming my way. A community has formed. Voices have come together, and a chorus of voices have found some harmony. Of course, it's not enough. We still have a waiting list. Our doors are still open because the world still needs shaping and colouring to include our glorious spectrum. It was time our community was given space to accept and find our own still fragile, worthwhile voice over the noise of conforming, normalising and, of course, masking. This book gives us all a space to breathe. To make a list, if you like to. Warning. You may laugh. You will likely cry, but you will find something that resonates. Pooky, with the shared voice of our community, reminds us that we can bond and connect. We should and can find joy and acceptance. We do need to care for ourselves as much as, if not more than, we do our children. Introduction. Welcome to this book, which aims to provide guidance, support, and empowerment to neurodivergent parents on their parenting journey. Neurodivergent individuals are those whose neurological functioning differs from the neurotypical population, encompassing conditions such as autism, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, and other brain-related variances. This is the book I wish I could have read a little earlier on in my parenting journey. I'm a late diagnosed autistic mother of two autistic daughters, one biological, one adopted. Parenting has been the greatest privilege in the world, but it's certainly not been easy. casting around desperately for advice on how on earth to live well and parent well as an autistic adult, I found myself drawing blanks. So I decided to do the research and write the book that so many of us desperately need. I've had over 100 neurodivergent adults share their experiences and ideas to shape the content. You'll see their voices woven throughout the book. In addition to the illustrative quotes, most of the ideas in the quick read sections are direct quotes from the community. I'm excited by what we've created together because it has the potential to bring profound change to many neurodivergent parents and carers out there. The process of researching and writing it has transformed my own outlook and actions, and many of those who contributed have remarked on how the conversations we've had and the ideas we've shared have helped their parenting to blossom. This book is for anyone who wants to read it. Maybe you've done waiting lists and diagnostics and had a bunch of reports to prove your neurodivergence. Maybe you self-identify as autistic or ADHD. Or maybe you're still at the wondering stage, just curious, or reading with a partner or significant other in mind. Whatever, you're welcome here. You're also welcome here no matter what shape your family takes. In my home, we have two children, my husband, myself, my mother-in-law, and a whole bunch of pets. But maybe you're a lone parent, a gay parent, a foster carer, an uncle, or you're someone working hard to co-parent following separation. Whatever shape your family takes, this book is for you. There is no right or wrong reader, and I hope that whatever your neurotype and whatever the shape of your family, you'll feel welcomed and inspired by what you read. Whilst you can use this book in any order you wish, I provided a brief summary below of the order in which I've tackled things and what I was hoping to achieve in each section. The book will work well read cover to cover, but equally, you might choose to dive straight into any topic that appeals to you or that feels pertinent right now. There are no rules. There's a real mix of short, punchy, quick read sections and longer, in-depth chapters to try and keep things interesting for my ADHD friends, whilst I hope that the logical structures that you'll see repeated throughout will appeal to my autistic friends. Throughout the book, you'll find sections called Your Turn that invite you to reflect and write down your thoughts. These sections are designed to help you personalise the information in the book to your own experiences and needs. You don't have to fill them in if you prefer not to, and you can always come back to them later. If you find that you have more to say than the space provided, feel free to use a journal or extra paper to continue your reflections. Section 1. Cultivating your neurodivergent potential. In this section, we embark on a journey of self-discovery and well-being. We explore topics like self-identity, self-care, and how to harness your unique neurodivergent strengths to foster positive relationships and build essential support networks. Section 2. Navigating neurodiversity's challenges. Here, we delve into the challenges that neurodivergent parents often face, from sensory differences and handling unsupportive people to managing intense emotions like anger and anxiety. This section equips you with strategies to navigate these external and internal hurdles. Section 3. Mastering neurodivergent parenting. This section guides you through the practical aspects of parenting whilst embracing your neurodivergent identity. We explore how to manage conflicts, handle social events, and address various family dynamics. Section 4. Finding joy. Our final section is dedicated to helping you find joy in your parenting. We'll explore the pleasure to be found in embracing our authentic selves, hunt for the everyday joys that parenting can bring, and consider how to celebrate the positives whilst reframing the negatives. The book ends with heartwarming stories from fellow parents, all echoing the resounding theme of joy in the beautiful chaos of neurodivergent family life. I hope you'll find that this book is not just a guide, but a companion on your neurodivergent parenting adventure. Throughout, I encourage you to reflect, connect with the content, and tailor it to your unique experiences. Your journey is personal, but hopefully the many voices shared in these pages will help you to feel a little less alone in it. Love, Pooky. Section 1. Cultivating your neurodivergent potential. In this section, we embark on a journey of self-discovery and well-being, We explore topics like self-identity, self-care, and how to harness your unique neurodivergent strengths to foster positive relationships and build essential support networks. Chapter 1. Quick read. Self-care. We cannot be the adults that our children need unless we first take care of ourselves. Children need good role models and adults who have the mental and physical bandwidth to meet their needs. So, we're going to consider self-care here, right at the start of the book, because it underpins all that is to follow. Self-care was a topic that split the community during my research. Some people were quick to extol the virtues of self-care and talked about its absolute necessity in their day-to-day life. Others saw it as yet another social construct designed around the needs of neurotypicals and which didn't help them at all. What's the point? Why should we force what doesn't come naturally? People say you'll feel better. Well, I don't. I just have to play catch-up to make up for the lost time. Lying around, wasting my day with cucumber slices on my eyes is a hugely inefficient waste of my time, and forced self-soothing will never trick me into believing my circumstances are anything other than the truth. So, I share these top tips with a little trepidation, and with the proviso that, as with all of the ideas in this book, it's about finding what resonates with you. Look for what feels like it could work in your life, and perhaps make things feel more manageable. I loved this definition of self-care that came from a member of the community. Self-care is consciously looking after your own physical, medical, and emotional needs and well-being. I think it can be a conscious, practical effort because you know it's needed, but it can also be a deeper, kinder care as well, one you'd apply to someone you love. Self-care doesn't have to mean bubble baths and yoga, though it can be those things if they work for you. Self-care might mean rigid routines, gaming, or reading books about meteorology. Self-care is something that I personally neglected in the past. I put others first in my work and in my home. I denied myself sleep, nutrition, compassion, and fun. After a long period of breakdown and burnout in my 30s, I rebuilt my life, and these days self-care is a big component. For me, it looks like getting enough sleep, building in intense exercise like bouldering or hill hiking, taking care to eat enough, and making space for family, friends, and fun. I used to think I didn't have time for self-care. It felt frivolous and time-wasting. But a few years into my self-care experiment, I can conclude that when I look after myself, I'm able to be a better parent, partner, and professional, with less illness and more joy. So I intend to continue. Additionally, I'd be far happier for my children to copy my current behaviours than my past ones. I'm a much better self-care role model for them these days. There is no right way to do self-care, but hopefully some of the tips below that were shared by the community might help you to think about how to be a little kinder to yourself and look to carve out a little time and energy to care for yourself as well as for others. Look forwards, not back. Self-care isn't another stick to beat yourself with about not having got things right in the past. It's learning what you need and how you can implement that going forward. How to incorporate it into your life, only you can answer. I am like an oil tanker. It takes me a long time to turn around, but the small changes have made a big difference to my course. The whole family will benefit from your self-care. Meeting your self-care needs in a timely way will benefit everyone in the long run. There is a way you can get what you need and live a balanced, more content life, where you feel emotionally stable. It might mean some adjustments to your own and everyone else's expectations, but it is possible. Do it every day. Self-care is like brushing your teeth. You might not always feel like doing it, but it is an important and necessary part of every day. You have to put the effort in and make sure it happens. It keeps you healthy. Share ideas amongst the family. We talk often about making sure that every day we do something we love, get some fresh air, and do some movement. We talk about what we've chosen that day. It's different for each of us. We also keep a notebook on the landing, and most evenings before bed, write down something we've loved today. I love planting that seed of a great moment just before sleep. You deserve it, no matter how busy you are. It's like people say, put your own oxygen mask on before helping others. You can only do what you can do, And sometimes it's okay just to do nothing if that's the self-care that works for you. Self-care doesn't have to be some big event. It shouldn't be yet another thing that you're failing at. Have a cup of tea, listen to the birds, breathe, put on your favourite song, wash your hair, get your nails done. Diarise it. I put it in my schedule so I have time set aside to do it, even if I'm feeling quite good. I tend to do self-care when the kids are in bed or at school. Self-care to prevent rather than cure. It helps me greatly to do maintenance self-care rather than reacting to feeling depleted. Work out how to motivate yourself. I try to drink plenty of water each day. As I don't often feel thirsty, it's a very conscious decision. I therefore bought myself some nice bottles that I liked, knowing it would motivate me to use them. Don't be afraid to buck the norm. Co-sleep with your child if that's what they need. Give up the battle to force them to be alone and scared at night. Change the sleeping arrangements in your home so you do not spend hours on the bedroom floor of your child's room or sat on the landing outside their door. Just buy a big enough bed that you will fit in comfortably and ignore advice from well-meaning but autism-ignorant supernannies. Explain your needs to your children. Explaining, even for young children, the needs you have as a parent and why can really help. My partner needs a lot of recovery time and cannot cope with things being out of place or noise. Trying to explain this to the children does help. It is hard, but as always, keeping the dialogue open and honest helps. It's important to try and set boundaries. Our children know that our bedroom is out of bounds for them. Think about your own personal scaffolding. Who do you know who can love you and hold you up? One or two people who get you and make you feel stronger is enough. Find activities that recharge your batteries. Look for things that offer you a break from your thinking brain. Things that give you a sense of connecting with your body and going with the flow, like painting, meditating, listening to a talking book whilst in a hammock, or something more energetic if that's what you need. Seek awe and wonder. Perhaps in the night sky, through time in nature, or by appreciating art or music. Get moving. What can you do to move your body? Dancing, walking, somatic shaking? It's so important for moving feelings and stress through and out of your body. Wear what feels good. I am learning how to physically be comfortable each day. I'm reassessing my wardrobe and asking if I like wearing things or if I just think it's something I should wear. For fashion reasons or what I think work expects. I'm also considering underwear and noticing how distracted my bras can make me with uncomfortable textures and pressures. I've realised how important it is to be comfortable at a basic clothing level in order to not put unnecessary stress on myself throughout the day. Be kind to your future self by planning ahead. I become overwhelmed by cooking and all the processes around it. Deciding what to eat, making a shopping list, buying everything, unpacking, then cooking every day. However, by making a weekly meal plan and doing my weekly shop, I have taken away the daily task of having to decide what's for dinner, and I avoid needing to go to the shops after work or after school with my autistic son, which is a disaster. I am mentally exhausted after work, so my previous decision-making means less processing at a time when I'm fighting off a shutdown. Suggested self-care activities. When I asked the community what works for them in terms of self-care activities, the answers were very varied. Perhaps some of these might work for you too, or might inspire you to think up ideas of your own. Here is a selection. Reducing demands and sensory overwhelm. Writing lists. Walking the dog. Walking in the countryside. Going for a run. Breathing or mindfulness. Talking things through. Going to my room and lying on the bed, reading, or just staring into space. Taking time alone. Sleeping in the spare room. Sleeping under a weighted blanket. Managing expectations of myself. Being realistic and kind to myself. Doing things that feed my creativity. Taking a silent bath. Looking at my food and fluid intake. Dipping into my sensory box full of calming things. Snuggling in a heated blanket, diffusing my favourite scented oils to either calm or energise, eating favourite foods. Locking myself in a room and not coming out for a bit. Getting creative in a quiet space. Organising, tidying and ordering things. Watching trashy TV. Taking a night away with my partner. Taking time off work. Taking quiet time alone, reading, baking, gardening, drawing, tidying, almost anything, as long as it's done in a relaxed way, not a whirlwind of urgency. Eating alone. Stepping into nature and stopping to take notice of the sights and sounds. People watching. Journaling. Reading in a nook or a hammock. Crocheting or knitting. Heavy exercise, running, lifting, climbing. Something fun and active that fills your whole mind, like ice hockey. Singing in a choir. Revisiting happy memories through photographs. FaceTiming a friend who gets it. Watching my favourite show. Anything that makes me laugh. Writing either with or without purpose, depending on my mood. Watching my lava lamp. Stroking a pet. Weeding or watering my garden. In this chapter, we've explored the diverse perspectives on self-care within our community. For some, self-care is an essential practice, whilst for others, it may not come naturally. Regardless of where you stand, it's essential to remember that self-care isn't a one-size-fits-all concept. It's about finding what resonates with you, what makes your daily life more manageable, and what allows you to care for yourself as you care for others. Whether it's a simple cup of tea, a walk in nature, or planning ahead to ease life's demands, self-care is an act of kindness towards yourself. Your turn. As you engage with the Your Turn reflection activities, consider how you can integrate self-care into your daily routine, benefiting not only yourself, but also your family's well-being. Reflect on your current understanding of self-care. Has it been a concept you've embraced or struggled with? Share any personal experiences related to self-care that have shaped your perspective. Consider the analogy that self-care is like brushing your teeth, a daily necessity. How can you integrate self-care into your daily routine? Are there specific self-care activities that resonate with you? Share your thoughts on the idea that self-care can benefit not only you, but also your family. How do you envision implementing self-care practices that contribute to a more balanced and content family life? Think about the self-care strategies mentioned by the community in the suggested self-care activities box above. Are there any activities that particularly stand out for you? How might you incorporate them into your self-care routine? Reflect on the concept of self-care as a form of kindness to your future self. Have you already implemented any strategies like planning ahead or creating routines to ease daily stressors? And if not, how might you start incorporating these practices into your life? Chapter 2. In depth, developing positive parent-child relationships. It can be challenging to develop a positive relationship with our children when just managing ourselves day to day can feel like a pretty tall order. My research showed, though, that there are lots of things we can do to support the development of relationships that work for our unique families. I was also excited to discover that as well as some pretty hefty challenges, there were also some aspects of our relationships that were enhanced compared to those experienced by our neurotypical peers. An important thing to remember whilst reading this chapter is there is no right way and wrong way, only the way that works for you and your family. It's also important to remember that you're not alone in any struggles you're facing, so please try not to beat yourself up too much. Finally, things can change. I remember being terrified at the prospect of becoming a mum. I didn't think I had it in me to develop a meaningful relationship with a child, and I was quite sure I didn't have the requisite levels of patience and compassion needed. It didn't come naturally to me. Mine was not an instant perfect love, but one that grew over time. It's still growing, and I'm always trying to learn more and work on it. My daughters are teenagers now, and I love them more than I ever have, though there are days when I question everything. They've taught me a lot about love and relationships, and as they get older and I gain in confidence, we're able to genuinely enjoy each other more and more. Before diving into ideas to support you in your relationships, I'm going to share the experiences of other neurodivergent parents and carers. I'm going to share the challenges first before sharing the good bits of their relationships. This is to help you realise that you're not alone in this journey if you're struggling. But there is reason to be hopeful. We are absolutely able to develop brilliant relationships with our children. Sure, things might look a bit different in our homes than in other people's, but that doesn't have to be a bad thing. Shared experiences, the lows. When I asked parents and carers to share challenges they faced in their relationships with their children, this is what they said. We are poles apart and rarely see eye to eye. She often doesn't feel my love, respect, humour, compassion, or empathy, as I do these things in a way that she can't access. They think I'm being lazy when I'm overwhelmed. They think I'm being attention-seeking when I'm being creative. My child is exuberant, noisy, and constantly moving and climbing. It often feels too overwhelming, and I'm often unable to find a quiet place to regulate myself. I get so tired and depleted. My children are demanding and draining. I want to meet their needs in a superhuman way because they are wonderful human beings, but their self-confidence and self-belief is very low due to the world breaking their hearts too many times. It's hard when their needs impact on mine. For instance, I need some time and space to myself to regulate, and they need me to co-regulate. Or my son needs music and movement to help him, and I need peace and calm. I haven't been very honest with my children about my own childhood. They have mostly been very secure and have strong attachments, but I did not experience that growing up. I've been determined not to let my dysfunctional family impact on my own children, but I'm not sure that it's helped them to understand me. I didn't have patience with him when he was a toddler playing with toys. I couldn't see the point of some games. When her anxiety is building, I find mine rises too, because I want to take it away from her, but I can't, and this leads to me feeling helpless and sad. My youngest is chaos incarnate. He makes mess, he does not mind food on his hands and his face, and he goes from one task to another very quickly. This can be very triggering for me, especially food mess. I try to remind myself this is normal development for a one-year-old, but I can't help but feel like he's doing it on purpose. I like to run to timescales to prevent anxiety. My children don't like to have the same routines, structures, or timescales as my own. This causes anxiety and frustration. I'm often trying really hard to control my own anxiety or emotions when trying to listen or be present with them. I'm always on the go or doing things whilst listening. I worry that they don't feel heard or understood, and that I don't model focus and calm. Shared experiences, the highs. When I asked parents and carers to share the best bits about their relationships with their children, this is what they said. They trust me to believe what they tell me about their experience or feelings, and they are absolutely certain that I love them. They are forgiving of my frequent mistakes and compassionate for my flaws, whilst still declaring me the best mama in the world. Being an autistic mother to two autistic children, I am better able to empathise with their experiences. I can also share in their sensory joy. I like not following the rules. I like to follow what works well for us. It is often not what everyone else is doing. We have a very open and honest relationship. They know my triggers and I know theirs. My neurodiverse son and I have a true connection that I cannot put into words. I am able to advocate for him in ways no one else can because no one else understands what he's going through as much as me, his neurodiverse mother. We do not need words. We have oodles of empathy and an enormous amount of consideration for one another. We respect downtime and celebrate mistakes and learning. There is just so much love. We have a very open and honest relationship. He will tell me about everything, including maybe things I'd rather not know about. 10 things you need to hear. Here are 10 things that I and other autistic parents and carers thought it was important for you to hear. 1. It's normal not to always enjoy parenthood. 2. It's okay to politely ignore the suggestions and advice of others. 3. Don't try to be a neurotypical parent. It won't work. 4. You are not a bad parent. You are a different parent. 5. It's okay to get stuff wrong. Apologise to your kids when this happens. 6. You have your limits. This is okay to admit and not okay to ignore. 7. Try not to feel guilty about not being able to do it all. 8. It is up to you and your child to decide how your relationship looks. 9. You are good enough. You are not perfect, but that's okay. 10. You cannot be kind to your children unless you are kind to yourself. The ideas. For each theme in this book, we explore a range of ideas that you can adapt for use in your day-to-day life. These ideas are all inspired by fellow neurodivergent parents and carers who've shared what works for them. Take a look and cherry-pick the ideas that you think might work for you right now. You can always revisit the others later. The ideas explored in the following pages are: Idea 1. Embrace being a successful neurodivergent parent, not a failed neurotypical one. Idea 2. Bond quietly. Idea 3. Clear expectations. Idea 4. Enjoy the child you have. Idea 5. Be open and honest. Idea 6. Have one-to-one time. Idea 7. Take time for you. Idea 8. Listen. Idea 9. Lean into fun. And Idea 10. Forgive the ruptures and focus on repair. Idea 1. Embrace being a successful neurodivergent parent, not a failed neurotypical one. It can be easy to compare ourselves to other parents and find that we're not matching up. There are a myriad reasons for this, not least that we're often comparing our bloopers reel with the highlights reel that everyone else chooses to share whilst their bloopers are left on the cutting room floor. Even so, as neurodivergent parents, we will have different strengths and challenges than our neurotypical peers, and we're likely to parent a little differently in consequence, and that's okay. The very best way to parent is the way that works well for you and your family, regardless of what is typical or normal. Forgiving yourself for doing things the way that works for you and viewing this through the lens of success as a neurodivergent parent rather than failure at attempting a neurotypical route is one way to relieve a lot of the burden of feeling not good enough every day. You are good enough. You just do things a little differently, and that's okay. In fact, it's more than okay, because sometimes the way you do things will be better than the norm. 5 things you could try. 1. Ask friends and family about your parenting strengths. Even if you feel like you're getting it wrong a lot of the time, the chances are that those who live with and love you would be able to tell you about all the things you do get right. We can become quite blind to these in our day-to-day life, so actually asking our family or friends can be eye-opening. Whilst it might feel a little bit awkward to ask someone to list our strengths, it can be both affirming and surprising to hear what they have to say. Many of the parents who contributed to this book did this exercise and wrote me emails of thanks for prompting them to do so, as it felt so good. Many of them discovered that some of the things they considered weaknesses were in fact seen as strengths by their children. You can also return the favour and tell a friend or family member about the things that make them a great parent in your eyes. Our neurotypical peers often have a lot of parenting hang-ups too. They may take a different shape than ours, but years of working with parents and carers has taught me that many of the really good ones feel like they're not doing a good enough job. 2. Cleanse your social media feeds. One of the things that can really contribute to the constant feeling of not good enough and comparing our parenting with that of others is our social media feeds. Being regularly confronted with the highlights of other people's parenting journey when we're just about managing to make it through each day can feel like being constantly beaten down. Take a good look at the accounts you follow and ask yourself honestly whether they are net positive or net negative when it comes to your mood and feelings about yourself. Cleansing our feed and removing the accounts that most often make our stomachs twist can make a big difference. You might choose to replace them with people who feel more like your tribe, people who get it and perhaps face similar challenges to yourself, or who are simply more honest and authentic in their journey. This exercise might cause you to stop and reflect on who you spend time with in real life as well. If you find that the feeds you most want to delete due to their toxicity are those of people you regularly spend time with, then you might want to quietly consider whether the time you spend with those people is net positive or not. Some people are far more open and honest when you see them face to face, in which case fine. But just as you don't have to continue to follow someone on social media if they make you feel terrible, you also do have some agency over who you would most like to spend time with face to face as well. Ideas for people to follow online. If you'd like to leverage your social media channels for good and fill it with voices that might inspire you on your parenting journey as a neurodivergent adult, these are some voices that were recommended by the community. Jody Clark. Jody is amazing because she totally gets the experience of being autistic and parenting autistic children. She's highly knowledgeable and has loads of resources on her website and social media pages. If you're lucky, you can work with her directly. She really cares. Website, jodyclark.co.uk. Facebook, Jody Clark Wiltshire. X, at Jody Smitten. Autistic Parents UK. Autistic Parents UK is an autistic-led charity committed to supporting autistic parents in a number of ways, including online peer support groups and monthly webinars. Website, autisticparentsuk.org. Facebook, Autistic Parents UK. Instagram, @autistic_parents_UK. X, @parentsautistic. Dean Beadle. Honest, deeply funny and doing brilliant work, a killer singer, songwriter to boot. Website, deanbeadle.wordpress.com. Facebook, dean.beadlespeaker. X, @deanbeadleuk. Heidi Mavier. Great on a no-holds-barred and suitably sweary approach to life. Website, heidimavier.com. Facebook, SEND support. YouTube, @HeidiWaddington. X, @HeidiMavier. Kieran Rose. Author, consultant, speaker, trainer, autistic parent, situationally mute, rogue researcher specialising in autistic masking, stigma and identity. Website, theautisticadvocate.com. YouTube, @theautisticadvocate. X, @KieranRose7. Sarah Jane Critchley. Supporting neurodivergent people and their loved ones and allies in achieving a joyful and fulfilling life. Website, differentjoy.com. Instagram, @SarahJaneCritchley. X, @SarahJaneCritch. Me, Pooky Knightsmith. Many of the community kindly recommended following me. Website, PookyKnightsmith.com. Instagram, @PookyH. YouTube, PookyH. Patreon, patreon.com/PookyH. X, @PookyH. 3. Do more of what you do differently. Everybody parents a little bit differently, and that's okay. Instead of feeling ashamed of the parenting quirks that set you apart from the crowd, lean into them. You'll have developed your parenting this way for a reason. And if there are approaches that work for you and feel manageable and good, do more of that, regardless of what everybody else seems to be doing. 4. Have a go-to coping statement. Coping statements can be a great way to displace difficult thoughts that circle in our heads. We can sometimes be our own worst enemies as our negative internal narrative is like a bully, constantly lurking in the shadows, waiting to pounce. Coping statements are phrases that we decide upon which present a different viewpoint and which we can repeat again and again in an attempt to diffuse and displace the mean words of our inner bully. For example, if you often find yourself thinking, "Why can't I do this? I'm useless." You might counter this with a coping phrase such as, "I'm not useless, I'm autistic," or, "I can do this, but I need to be kind to myself first." Creating coping statements. Thinking, at a time of calm, about the words we most need to hear from those we love can help us identify the best coping statements. Those statements might feel wrong in our mouths at first, but with practice they can become more helpful, and you might even start to believe them. Here are some coping statements suggested by fellow neurodivergent parents. I'm doing better than I think. Today is a hard day. It's okay to take it slowly. My children know they are loved. That is all that really matters. My way is okay. I am a good enough parent. I've done this before. I can do it again. I choose not to engage with these negative thoughts. I will do what I can and forgive myself for what I can't. I am a successful neurodivergent parent, not a failed neurotypical one. My children are fantastic. I'm doing something right. You may find that coming up with your own coping statements is a little harder, but even more effective than borrowing someone else's. 5. Delegate what you don't do well. If there are other people with whom you're able to share some of the parenting load, it can be helpful to discuss the parts of parenting you find especially challenging. Some tasks that push you to breaking point may feel easier for a partner or parent who might be happy to relieve you of those tasks specifically. Delegating the tasks that you find most physically or emotionally exhausting can mean that you're more able to engage with other parenting tasks. If you have a neurotypical partner or fellow parent, it's quite possible that you'll find that the bits of parenting that come more easily to you are the bits that they find most challenging, and vice versa. This can make these conversations a win-win, with everyone doing more of what they enjoy and excel at, whilst passing on those tasks they'd really rather not be doing. Idea 1 reflection. What's working well? What are you already doing? Could you do more of it? What would you like to change? What new ideas could you try? What tiny step could you commit to taking today or tomorrow to work towards a different way of doing things? Idea 2. Bond quietly. Bonding can feel like a high-stakes game, with many of us aware of the importance of developing a secure attachment with our child, whilst also finding it very difficult to do so. This can be especially true in the early days, weeks, and months of parenthood when everything has changed and we're faced with a whole new human to get to know and love, but who might feel pretty overwhelming for us. The good news is that you can build and reinforce a secure bond with a child without being an all-singing, all-dancing parent. What our children need more than anything else is a quiet consistency. Simply being predictably and reliably present is an important starting point. The ideas I've shared can work well in the early weeks of parenthood, but can also be revisited any time you feel unable to connect with your children in other ways and need a quieter way to continue to reinforce your bond with them. 5 things you could try. 1. Just be there. Simply reliably showing up for your child is the first step in bond building. Being physically and, if you can, emotionally present alongside your child can be enough. There are a myriad of reasons why it might be hard to do more than this sometimes, but this can be enough. In my own parenting journey, I've reverted to this tactic often. Most notably with 6-month-old Ellie, fresh to us from foster care, who cried continuously and wouldn't be held. I sat by her cot, just there, nothing more, for what felt like weeks. It took time, but that bond did build as she started to feel settled. A few years later, when my body was so ravaged by anorexia that I had the strength to do nothing but lie in a hospital bed, my girls got in and lay with me. I told them I loved them. I could do no more at the time, but it was enough. Sometimes, when we can do no more, our consistent physical presence is enough. It might be that you need to put in noise-cancelling headphones just to be able to bear to be near your crying baby. But if you can find a way to just be there, it's a good enough first step. 2. Use routines and rituals to make small moments special. Even the most mundane everyday tasks can turn into moments of bonding with a little bit of thought. developing routines and rituals to accompany tasks like feeding, nappy changing, and bedtime can make these moments feel safe and familiar for children of all ages. This might mean doing things in a similar order, using the same words, singing the same song, putting on the same music or noise. You might get more adventurous and add little games into the ritual. Whatever you like, really, just things that add a feeling of safety and sameness. As well as creating safe, predictable moments for your child, which will aid bonding for you both, this can also make many tasks feel more manageable for you as well, as the familiar is generally less anxiety-provoking than anything new. Sometimes as parents, we think we have to be exciting and inventive and constantly doing new things to stimulate our children, but sameness is soothing and will aid secure attachment. So find what works for you and rinse and repeat. 3. Caring touch. Touch builds a physical bridge between parent or carer and child. But this can feel challenging for some of us, and sometimes for our children too. Explore what feels good for you, and also what your baby or child responds to well. Some children will love gentle touch or stroking. Some will like hand-holding or tickling. Others will like deep touch or hugging. Whilst others might simply like to feel your body curled around theirs. Notice what feels good and build more of it into your regular routines. These little moments can also be superb for co-regulation as your bodies fall in sync with one another and you begin to feel more content and calm. 4. Sing. One of the best pieces of advice I was ever given as a new parent is, it's almost impossible to feel angry when you sing. Many parents and carers find themselves feeling angry or irritable with their baby, who may be the source of lack of sleep and lots of noise. We can end up feeling frustrated and helpless about how to make things better. Run down and lacking in self-care, we're far more likely than usual to feel angry or to melt down. And this can lead to further guilt, shame, or frustration, as we know that this won't help us or our baby. So try singing. It really does work. I went for something simple, Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, whilst I paced up and down, willing my baby to be quieter. You might be a little more inventive in your musical choices, but either way, you may well find that singing helps to diffuse your anger and may help your baby to calm too. Because even if you don't think you have a great voice, it will sound wonderful to your little one. 5. Watch together. If you're looking for ways to quietly build bridges with older children, watching something together can work well. A film, favourite TV show, a YouTube channel they're into, or their favourite TikToker. Let them choose and just sit calmly with them, quietly showing an interest and letting them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.